IVM.
Hello and welcome to episode 2 of Getting Meta, my new podcast. Thank you so much for joining in, whether you heard my voice on Simplified or The Origin of Things before, or if you're hearing me for the very first time. In short, this is a podcast where I, Deepak, or Chuck as the world calls me, speak to some very smart people to unravel their habits, thought processes, tools, mental models, so that anybody else in any field can sort of apply them as well. This show focuses less on the achievements of the people who I speak to and more on them as a person and their ways of thinking. Hence, I get meta with them. Each episode aims to inspire, entertain, and leave you with lots of questions to ask yourself, frameworks to apply, and of course, a lot of great content to check out. In the debut episode that released last week, I spoke to podcaster and writer Amit Verma of the Seen and the Unseen fame. And for the second show, I have the very funny and thoughtful Rohan Joshi, aka Mojo Rojo, on. Now, you guys will know Rohan as one of the most recognizable faces in the alternative culture space in India. He's best known for being a stand-up comic who co-founded the popular collective All India Bakchod, or AIB. Having followed his work and his Instagram for years, I've found him to be a very thoughtful guy, well-read, empathetic, and very, very wide-ranging interests. When I had the idea for the show, he was easily in my initial shortlist of people to speak to. And hey, I even owe him the idea for this show that will be revealed in the episode. So we're going to discuss a lot of things, including Rohan's experiences as a comedian, teacher, and journalism student, having a finite well of energy and how to maximize it, starting the day on a great note with a simple hack, the importance of structure in life, how Rohan dealt with fame that came with the astronomical rise of AIB and how that changed his thinking, allowing yourself the luxury of letting your mind wander, having realistic goals and just enjoying the ride. And yes, of course, we also discuss cats. Before we begin, I must tell you what an amazing person Rohan is, exemplified by one simple act at the time of recording. We were supposed to speak at 3 p.m. on the day of recording, and his food hadn't arrived yet. But he made sure he got onto Zoom where we were recording to request whether he could take another half an hour for it. And that sort of punctuality, professionalism, and just being an all-around nice guy, his signature Rohan. All right, enough of this preamble. Let's get on with this. Please enjoy this conversation with Mojo Rojo or Rohan Joshi. Rohan, welcome to the show, man. Thanks so much for being on.
Thank you so much for having me.
The idea of this show is to sort of inspire listeners and, well, the host really, the habits, mental models, and worldview of some very smart people. That way, this show is actually less about your comedy and more really about the way you think, hence getting meta.
I'm going to panic a little bit because you're talking about inspiring other people, but this is probably a good time to admit that I am an extremely indisciplined worker slash writer. I'm a textbook Indian student. I'm a textbook Indian middle bencher in the sense that I'm not a back bencher. Yeah. I'm not a front bencher. I'm the guy that works best when I know the project is due in 2 days. And yeah, that's just what I wanted to say at the start. So any advice or anything that you perceive as advice over the course of the next hour, please take with a very large grain of salt. Or please remember that most of the tools that are mentioned in this advice will kick in 2 days before your project deadline.
I think that's perfect because I think we have been habituated to taking and seeking advice from the front benchers. So from the middle benchers is actually not a bad name for a property, if you think.
Yeah, from the middle bench.
Getting better from the middle bench. So I want to start with something very, very important. Everyone should have a cat. Discuss 5 marks.
Everyone should have a cat. Absolutely. Discuss 5 marks. Everyone should have a cat because cats are great content. They're like good feng shui on 4 legs. They're very entertaining. They take care of themselves by and large. They are loving, just in different ways from dogs. So get that misconception out of there.
Yeah.
Some people get tattoos. Some people get henna tattoos. Some of us just get nice temporary swaggy scars all over our body. Yeah, got one right here right now that's healing. Yeah. So yeah, those are all the reasons that you should have cats. Also very Instagrammable.
Yeah, just different ways of showing love, really. Rohan, in many ways, I have you to thank for the show itself, really. Don't know if you might remember. In December 2019, Innocent Times, I was doing a feature for a website that I write for, and we wanted to get like a small tip from a few people, and one small thing that they did that they that had an outsized effect. And I pinged you on WhatsApp, and your reply came 4 minutes later, and was as specific as I could have ever hoped for.
I spend way too much time on my phone, is what you're saying.
Productivity tip number one, which is you changed your alarm tone. And that got me thinking and said, yeah, I mean, I'd love to have like a show where we speak to people about stuff like this. So one, elaborate on that a little, and two, whether you found any other hacks like that ever since that have made you happier, peaceful, anything at all, really.
I have. So the context here is that I have anxiety. I've been dealing with anxiety for a while. And what I realized was that I was just waking up in like either an extremely sort of anxious state or like completely a flutter and like just sort of 100 things going through my mind, but not, I have to do this also, I have to do this also, I have to do this also. And just generally waking up in a state of, I think what you can describe as agitation. And then I realized that part of what was happening was it was just the way I was waking up. I was waking up like people in thriller movies or horror movies where, you know, it's like even like, like, I was waking up like that, like as opposed to normally. And I realized that that's because the, and it ascends gradually in volume. And I wake up more like, okay, I have things to do today. And I found that just that difference in how I started my day, the analogy I draw to it is if your car is at the signal and the light turns green and you either slam the accelerator down and let go of the clutch and you get that jerk start and that sort of wheel spin and then start, versus just sort of coasting gently off the signal. And I found that was immediately making a difference to how I started my day.
Yes,
the other thing I do is, for the first, the other thing I've realized now to further that routine is if I can avoid it, all I do is check the home screen of my phone once. I see if there are any crucial text notifications from, say, people I need with waiting to hear from overnight, or say somebody from the family has messaged and they don't usually message that early in the morning. If not, I just try to not look at my phone after that for the first 30 to 40 minutes of the day. I have cut my news consumption down to very specific things. I only read 2 newspapers now, and that's all my news. I don't read any online news. I'm not on Twitter. I don't check my phone for any of that stuff when I wake up in the morning. And I found that that just is a better start to the day. And say, even if there is terrible information or terrible stuff to be learned in the course of that day, if I can sort of learn that over the course of the day, as opposed to just diving into it headfirst in the morning, whether it's a Twitter shitstorm or whether whatever it is, I find that I'm able to lead my days way more productively and just in a way where my mind is a little more focused, as opposed to just constantly going off in different anxious spirals or tangents.
That's fantastic. Like I've switched off all notifications on my phone, and that's helped a fair bit. And the second thing that you said with respect to the news, even though that's a stream that I don't necessarily want to go down, but I try to get my news from newsletters that I have specific times to consume, and you get that little sense of context rather than, like you said, the
exactly, which is why I like consuming a finite amount of information as opposed to just extremely emotionally high-strung reactions to that information, which is what 90% of social media is. It's never just the information. It's always just extremely emotive reactions to that information. And then when you're taking in the information solely through the reactions, you're getting it with all those emotions that you're never getting. And one place where it helps, having had a slight journalistic background and having gone to journalism school, is I was formally trained to follow the information as opposed to following the reaction around the information. And so I've managed to, after first, like sort of falling into social media, kind of like a cokehead, falling face first into a pillow of cocaine. After I sort of pulled myself out of that, I've sort of managed to use that training to, again, just train myself to seek out specific information and then act on that. And then obviously also take emotive and moral stands as and when my conscience dictates I must. But doing that when I feel like it's something that I need to and want to and have a reason to do, rather than doing it just because I'm just standing in the center of some perceived Twitter maelstrom about it, which is where I think we find ourselves a lot of times when we're on social media. We constantly, the more we are on these things, we think we're at the center of great big circles and tides and eddies going on. And you step back and you realize that really not.
Yeah. The last 10 years have been fascinating from that perspective, hasn't it? Like how Twitter was when, you know, we were just hanging out back in 2009, 2010, and what it's ended up becoming. But I think that's a completely different discussion for another
whole separate
show. So let's not go down that needless rabbit hole. So coming back to topic at hand, so one of the reasons why I wanted you on, and you can correct me if any of my assumptions about you are wrong, really. Like, I've always felt that, and I wanted to speak to you specifically, because I always felt that, you know, here's one guy who whatever he does is with a certain purpose, right? Or is with, you know, everything, like there's a certain plan to what you're doing. Like, for example, I remember long back when you were talking about your fitness routine, for instance, you very specifically said, yeah, I mean, I have days for binging, for example. Like now I like that fits a certain, I was like, all right, that's interesting. Like everything that he does is with a certain, there's no ambiguity in your head sometimes, whether it is with respect to work or whether it is with respect to play. One, am I wrong? And two, if I'm not wrong, have you kind of always been that way?
You're not wrong in the sense that in terms of like the sort of the broader picture of how I live my life, but it isn't about like purpose or sort of destiny so much as it is. I'm not the world's most energetic person in the sense that there are some people that can spend their day doing 10 or 15 different things and crush it at every one of those things. That's one of those things that I'm very envious of people like Tanmay for, right? Tanmay is one of those people where if you watch him work, he can do 15 things at a time and somehow find energy, focus, time, devotion to all of those things. I personally am not like that. I'm the sort of person that has what feels like a very finite well of energy. And like I mentioned earlier, I have discipline issues. So I have to create, it becomes extremely important for me to create routine and then attach meaning to that routine to be able to stick to that routine. So again, in my case, what happened with the exercising was I realized that it was physically making me feel better. Mm-hmm. I was feeling healthier physically as a result of doing it. This was translating into better mental health as a result of sort of every alternate day getting a very healthy, non-chemical endorphin hit, where it's not coming from alcohol or drugs or any of that stuff, but coming solely from putting my body through something. And then I find that structure of Monday, Wednesday, Friday gym then becomes the foundation for another structure. Where now I know that if I have Monday, Wednesday, Friday gym, that means that therapy has to be Tuesday or Thursday. Or if therapy is on Tuesday, then some other admin work has to happen Thursday morning, which means then I have to stack afternoons up for office work. So I feel like what happens with me is I like sort of A, being very picky about the things that I do because I have a finite well of energy, and then trying to create routines around doing those things. Because I find that becomes structure. I need structure to sort of as the antidote to my indiscipline otherwise.
Right.
It's also why, and this is a bit of a tangent, but it's also why I enjoy writing collaboratively, because I'm way better at working when there's somebody across the table holding me accountable. And when there's somebody to challenge an idea that I put out, when there's a reason for, if we say 2:30, for me to be there at 2:30.
Yeah.
Like the simple difference is this, right? Today we were supposed to record at 3:00. We ended up recording at 3:45, but I got there at 3:00 and I had to tell you, hey, it's going to take me some time. If this was just me that was supposed to do something on my own at 3:00 today in the afternoon, I can't guarantee you that that is a thing that would have gotten done.
Yeah.
Because 3:00 at some point would have rolled around and I've been like, oh, my food's not here yet. And I'll just eat. And then I would have finished eating and been like, but now it's 4:00. And you know, at 5:30, I want to step out for a cup of coffee anyway. So what's the point of just sitting down to work for an hour now and all of that? So in that sense, yes, it's very important to me that the thing that I'm doing have purpose, because the only way I can do it. Like I did a lot of stand up when I knew I wanted to write a special, because again, it's like there's a deadline.
Yeah.
I don't know whether this is something that has happened to me as a result of our education system, where I just spent the first sort of 18 years of my life clinging to, it's like clinging to a life raft and you're going from like deadline to deadline to deadline, right? And that's how all your school work and your college work and everything happens, right? It's always for 3 years ye exam aa raha hai yaar, for 3 years ye assignment aa raha hai yaar, for 3 years ye final aa raha hai yaar, for 3 years ab to boards aa rahe hai. And fatriye suddenly becomes your routine,
your default,
right? And then now suddenly that becomes ke fatriye tab kaam hoga. So having to sit down next to another person is like a very baby version of fatriye. Yeah. यार अगर मैं 3 बजे नहीं पहुंचा तो इंसल्ट हो जाएगी ना आदमी की बिचारी, मतलब he's also taken out time, he's also sat down, it's doesn't look good, it's just all of that, and then you end up, yeah. At least then I end up,
yeah,
writing better.
No, fair enough. And no, I love what you said, and this is, I think you've countered that thing that you said in the beginning itself, that you don't have a way of thinking or something like this is something like this itself just shows how much you think about something like this. And I want to pick on one of the things that you said, which was recognizing your finite well of energy. I think that was one, it was beautifully put. And two, I love the contrast that you drew between yourself and say someone like a Tanmay who has that infinite well of energy. Then how, I think it's a matter of getting people to identify which of these they fall into, or whether there is some other, you know, restriction that they may have. And often I have found people who are a little confused or they don't know how to go about things. They can't identify a restriction like this, or they can't take it upon themselves to say, yeah, okay, you know what? I can't read every single book on the planet. I do have a finite well of energy or attention or something. How did you go about figuring that and sort of accepting that you don't have an infinite well of energy?
So I think part of the reason that I think a lot of people get confused about that or can't sort of commit to being maybe the type of person that they really are, one is there's of course the dimension of it where some people may just not have a choice, right? Today, again, fully acknowledging my privilege in a lot of places, spaces, etc., to acknowledge that I have a choice to be this person, that I have the choice to not hustle constantly if I don't want to, right? That's one thing. Two is, there's also a bunch of people that might have the privilege to do it, but aren't doing it because there is like this cultural smokescreen of hustle culture, right? Yeah. We all live in this sort of culture that's constantly telling us to hustle. That's constantly telling us to like, what's your next goal? What's your next thing? What's your next big achievement? Yeah. What's the next company you're going to grow and sell off? And what's the next book? And what's the next Instagram post that's going to get a million? And when are you getting to 500,000 followers? When are you getting to a million followers? And when are you and when? And there's no end to it. And I feel like it's very easy to, especially if you're surrounded by that culture and if you're surrounded by people who are excelling in that culture, it's very easy to fall into the trap of feeling like you're not doing enough and that you have to be as aware or as constantly on top of it as these people. And then I was very fortunate to be very deep in the behind the scenes of hustle culture as a result of like, you know, just the amount of work we did at AIB, for example, right, between just I think 2013 and 2018, just the output was prodigious in terms of just how much we got done. And what part of the reason I realized and I was able to make this change is because as I got older, I reached a point where I physically crashed, where I was going into the room and lots was happening at AIB at that point. We were talking about making a movie and on air with AIB and this and that. And with all those thrilling things, some of my biggest dreams coming true, like the opportunity to soon write a movie, potentially direct a movie, etc., all of that, I couldn't muster up like an iota of joy. Like going to the office was going to the office. I wanted to go in there and I wanted to get out of there. And I realized that's because at some point I realized that I was just drained. I wasn't enjoying the process anymore because I'd done so much of it. There's no joy in the joke writing process because I'm not writing the joke for the sake of telling a funny joke. I'm writing this joke just because kal script dena hai aur khatam. Right? And that's it. And then there would be no gratification from that because the second that's sent off, there's 10 other things that need to be sent off. And it just got to a point where I'm like, I had this weird moment where I sort of sat up and went, this is the same sort of feeling that I had 3 days before I left engineering. Like, this is what that felt like. Just this feeling of drowning in this thing that was supposed to be your destiny. And I remember sort of finishing a bunch of projects and then just sort of off for months. Like where I just sat on my couch and there was a 2-week period where a lot of it was just about sitting on my couch and telling myself, you know what? No, you don't have to work today. There's nothing to do. you don't have to feel productive today. You don't have to. You worked your ass off. There's money in your bank account. There are future projects that you will go back to once this is done. All of that. But what is it all for? And I think that was the first time I had sort of stepped away from the sort of hustle culture crucible for a bit and just sort of gone, essentially stepped out of the party for a cigarette.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
For 2 minutes. It's like, you know, when you're at a party, you step out for 2 seconds and suddenly just feels different, right? When you walk into silence after that. And I think that was the first time in 6 years I just allowed myself to be exhausted and be okay with it. And I did things that I'd forgotten how to do, like sleep for 9 hours, go to bed at 10:30, wake up at 7:30, go for a run. That's when I started training and working out and doing all of these things and started realizing that I actually take enjoyment from a lot of other things. And while that may sound trivial, it is the act of taking enjoyment and nourishment from those things that then allows me to go back and translate all of that into jokes and writing and this and that. And I just sort of looked at my life and I went, what do I want? Like, what's my end game here? Like, am I going to be Steven Spielberg? No, it's unlikely. Am I going to be Dave Chappelle? Also highly unlikely. Am I even going to be like in the top 10 comedians in my country? Again, very unlikely. Like, I have a certain this thing about my ability, but very unlikely. I know that I'm somebody that whose best shot is at just making sure that every piece of work that they put out, they were proud to stand behind. So that doesn't matter how it's stacked up competitively against everybody else's, because that is beyond a point irrelevant. But how does it feel to sort of look back at it myself or to look at it myself? And also just realizing that I'm a person that likes sitting on their ass a lot.
Yeah.
I like sitting on balconies and looking at views of trees and beaches and mountains and things like that. I like sitting down and reading a book for the sake of reading a book. I like doing these things. And those are important aspects of what make me a complete person. And I just realized that in the long run, that meant more to me than whatever potential middle of a ladder I could attain with something else. And so instead I went, we'll just try and do quality over quantity.
Yeah.
And also the other thing that happened is because of being on social media all the time, I have spent the last 8 years of my life, basically like there's this serial killer algorithm behind me. And I just, every year you like bal bacho from it, right? Like things started, everything was great, lots of reach. Suddenly Facebook goes, we will not allow YouTube links to have organic reach on Facebook. Suddenly now run that algorithm by natively posting on Facebook. Suddenly Facebook goes without promotion, no content will spread organically. Now you're fighting that algorithm. Then you get onto Instagram and then Instagram goes, but now if you want to be seen, you got to make lots of reels, otherwise we won't show you to people. And then you're fighting that algorithm. And I just realized that I'm done with like, this capricious algorithm dictating what I do tomorrow. So I also have sort of made a more conscious decision where I'm like, I don't want this to be the sole focus of my career. I want to have like in terms of like fast food and slow food, social media is fast food. I also want a career in like traditional media in the sense that I want to have a career as a writer and I want to have a career as all of those things also. And I just think that takes a lot of soul. So to be able to just do all of that is I don't think a luxury that a lot of people in the rat race get.
Yeah.
Right? You don't have the luxury to just take 3 to 4 months off and just be like, I'm going to go stare at a wall, really interrogate what I want and need from my life and then take the steps to build that while also somehow being able to put enough of my ego aside to be like, maybe I won't be the best and maybe I won't be this and maybe realistically this is a goal, but then sort of finding happiness in that. And that I think I had the luxury to do it.
Yeah, no, that's wonderful. Thank you for like sharing that story. That was I wasn't aware of this myself, and we worked in pretty much the same office at.
Exactly. At so I mean, I'd show up with a smile on my face every day and be the perfect office mate.
I do want to clarify for anyone who's listening, however, that it might look like it's all easy on the surface, but I have seen the amount of. Work that goes behind everything that that you guys put out, be it a social media post or like a video or anything really for that matter. So it's definitely a crazy amount of work that goes behind all sorts of output that really happens. And I think that's something that people don't really identify. But going back to what you said, I think, so there are two broad takeaways really from there. One is that like allow yourself that time of soul searching. If you have the luxury to do a sabbatical or something like that, then great. But Yeah, I love the other thing that you said, just put your ego aside for a little bit. And I think that's also a matter of all the, like you said a while before, that like society telling you have to do this, you have to grow 10% year on year, you need to keep doing this. It's really about putting those expectations aside and just saying, okay, what do I want to do? What do I want to sort of get out of this life? I think that was...
And I think if you have the luxury to do that, it's absolutely something that I would recommend that people do.
Yeah. I haven't come across anyone who hasn't had a profound way of thinking about life after just stepping away, even if it's just for a day, even if it's just for a week, even if it's just like getting out of the rat race for a minute. All right, what am I doing this for? Of course, people have gone on to take sabbaticals for 2-3 months, gone to Vipassana or something. Obviously, they've come back with their life completely altered. But even if you're just able to step away for even just a few hours, honestly, per day.
What's that phenomenon that they say astronauts experience? Is it the observer? What is it? What's it called? Let me Google it. Overview effect. It's called the overview effect. And the definition of it, and I'm just reading the state off of Wikipedia. It's a cognitive shift in awareness that's reported by some astronauts during space flight, often while viewing the Earth from outer space. It's just not a thing that your brain expects. And then apparently when they turn back and they see how fragile and small it looks in the vastness of space, it apparently fundamentally shifts something in you that cannot be shifted back, because it's sort of like you've seen the Matrix. Your way of thinking is forever transformed as a result.
Fantastic.
And I think this is a small way of that. If you can just step out of your own life and your own hustle and your own all of that and really examine it critically, I think that some pretty wild, weird, and wonderful things can happen in your life.
Even the best of conversations need a bit of a breather once in a while. So before we continue, let's take a small break. See you guys in a bit.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Would like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, Kredge, Siet, and Global Victoria. Thank you so much for making this possible. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by the hilarious and extremely charming illusionist and therapist, Sohani Shah. They talk about different aspects of magic like sleight of hand, mind reading, mentalism, and more. The Habit Coach completed 500 episodes, 500, and Ashton has a special message for us on the occasion. Do check that out. We had Lekhini Desai, founder of the India Ethnic Company, talk to Varun Digirala about their story and the Hatke marketing idea that made them popular. On Nankari, Sadaf and Archis celebrated World Chocolate Day. They took us through the origins, history, economics of chocolate, and shared their memories. On Tere Mere Raste, Keshav Chaturvedi shares an interesting story from Leh. Check out an updated version of the Traveling Professor's Diary. It's now rechristened as Smarter with Sid. Same old brain fill with new stories and insights. This time, listen in to know why you should keep things simple. And finally, check out Global Victoria Tech Talks. This one is in partnership with Global Victoria, the trade arm of the government of Victoria and Australia. The edtech and gaming industries are booming in Victoria, Australia, and this series is meant to showcase that. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
And now, back to my conversation with Rohan Joshi.
All right, awesome. I want to ask you about sort of childhood, and in the sense, you know, I think that it's often some experience or content that we end up consuming during childhood that shape our world for better or for worse, right? This can come in many ways. I, for example, have got hugely inspired from very unintentional lessons of some fun comic strips or cartoons that I saw as a kid. Like, have you ever heard of Drabble by any chance?
I have not heard
the comic strip called Drabble. I'm not it used to be one of those things that we consumed.
What was it? One of the newspapers or what was it?
Newspaper. I grew up in the Gulf, so it was part of one of those youth magazines that we used to get. It's sort of like a Simpsons-like version. You know, same trope. You had a goofy, overeating dad, and you had some miscreant kids, one of which was very prodigious, and a wife who was like, oh, what am I going to do with this family sort of thing. So very similar to Simpsons in that sense. There's one comic in particular I remember, and I'm telling you this only to illustrate the point, I think you'll appreciate it. So the father, Ralph, he was Ralph Drabble, hence Drabble. He used to work as a security guy in a mall. So he was dressing up, putting all his thing on and putting the baton and uniform and everything for 6 trips. And then the last trip, he goes to bed. And his wife is up reading and saying the things that you won't do to get an extra couple of minutes sleep in the morning. And that's genius. That should not be censured. That's genius. So today, now, if I want to work out in the morning, I sleep with my socks and I put the mat in the room. And So these unintentional lessons. Another one that absolutely blew my mind was there was a Simpsons sorry, there were these Hanna-Barbera used to have comic strips at one point of time that you'd get free along with Maggie or something like that.
Yeah.
And one of them was a Flintstones graphic novel or a comic book, I suppose. And one of them was Fred Flintstone kept saying what would happen if he was beating himself up, and he said something like, I wish I'd never been born or something. So somebody came, some alien came and transported him to a world which there was no Fred Flintstone. Shows how, not Springfield, what is the name of the play? Bedrock. Wow. Bedrock was changed completely because this crucial character was not there. And that, like, it was a silly little cartoon, both of them, but it just changed my, holy shit, that's crazy. I'm just curious to know whether there's anything that you've come across. It could be like a certain cartoon show, a line that you read, an experience that you had that ended up shaping, you know, your worldview. Because the reason I asked this is because I think there'll be small kind of things that happen everywhere that unintentionally affect our lives.
So one really, this is going to sound absurdly trivial, all right? Because this is literally a line that I saw while I was in a doctor's waiting room, while reading an old magazine. It was an ad for sunglasses, and it was like just basic, like it was basic copy. And I'm sure it was one of those like, kahan se utha ke, like, simplest sentence in the world, but it stayed with me for a real, and it actually stayed with me ever since. Don't walk like you own the world. Walk like you don't give a shit who does. And that's something that I keep sort of coming back to, because I keep thinking about the pressures of actually ruling the world versus just getting yourself in a place where the act of ruling the world is just not a thing that matters to you anymore. Amazing. Right? And I feel like that's as stupid a line as that is, I've come back to it so many times in my life sometimes. And it's been the difference between sort of going on a fool's errand and just being like, you know what? No, I don't want to rule the world.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to make fun things and like be part of fun conversations. And that's all I've ever wanted to do. And that's one little thing that came back to me. And another thing that, what other little thing that changed my, not little thing. I do remember at the age of 16, I watched The Matrix for the first time in my life. That movie blew my fragile little mind. I think that was pretty much the point at which I decided I never wanted to wear a suit to work, like, ever. I think that movie fundamentally shifted things in me. And I also remember what that movie really moved about me was, that is the, still for me, the defining theatrical experience of my life. That was the day that I decided I wanted to spend my life making things that bring out emotions in people. Because I remember watching that movie for the first time. This is 1999. There's no internet. There's no trailers. There's no like gigantic marketing machine ahead of the movie in India. It's just this movie that's coming out. I've seen maybe one or two shots from a trailer once on Star Movies while it was playing. And I won these two tickets in a contest. So I sat down. I'm just sitting there in my chair and I can't get up because my knees are weak. And I'm like struggling to breathe because the sort of last 30 to 40 minutes of the movie were just so thrilling, so gripping, so sort of mind-blowing that I was having a physical, visceral reaction to them in that seat. Like my hands were cold, like my knees were shaking. I physically couldn't stand up. My friend was like, can we go? And I was like, just no. I didn't know then that I was preparing myself for a lifetime of Marvel post-credit scene sit-downs. I didn't know then at the time that that's what was happening. But I remember sort of walking out of that theater, and I just never in my life up until that point felt so consumed by a pop culture experience or a media experience. And I couldn't. And I remember the feelings being as strong, if not stronger, than any feelings I'd ever had attached to real world things that had happened to me. And that was the day where I came out and went like, I in my life want to make things that can make people feel emotion. Which is why I already feel like all my ambitions are over with the fact that I made a bunch of shit, or I was part of making a bunch of shit that have made people laugh. And that's a huge emotional reaction. And it's great.
Yeah.
So yeah, those were two sort of moments. One was a very silly magazine ad. And one like was The Matrix.
Yeah. Yeah, you've covered the spectrum. There's really nowhere to explore sort of beyond that. When you were saying that, I remember one of the other things that I had come across is actually from a line, I think, from Sports Star. And I think it was an interview that I think it was Sachin who was talking about Shane Warne or something. He said, and this is probably a very common line of advice in cricket anyway, which is play the ball on its merit and not the reputation of the bowler. And
sure.
I thought, wow, that's quite profound.
That's a great point.
In some way. Yeah, it is, right? Like, Yeah, these small little things, I think, hold a lot more wisdom than even possibly the author intended. I'm pretty sure that...
Oh, absolutely. I think we all add our own context and our own listening to it and then pull something from it, right?
Yeah, 100%. So, you spoke a little while about being a journalist. And actually, one of the things that I wanted to ask you was that you were also, if I remember correctly, a teacher at one point of time. Or at least
I was.
You had your thoughts. What did those experiences teach you, and in a way, did they shape your career in area or the stuff that was to come?
It taught me a fair amount because one of the fun things about being a teacher was I was a teacher in a subject that I myself had studied, obviously, right? And this was a really basic, fun cinema course. And what I realized was that if I'm dealing with a bunch of sort of 17-year-olds or 18-year-olds, and I want to get them to watch a movie at 8:30 in the morning, I'd better pick some really f***ing fun movies. I don't care what the course says. I don't care what this thing has to be. If the goal of this course is that I have to get them to a place where they have to understand concepts like mise-en-scene, sound, editing, cinematography, basics of that, theme, motif, all of that, I don't necessarily need to show them like a 3-hour Tarkovsky film at 8:30 in the morning to do that. And I feel like I'll have a lot more success if I try to translate the emotion of movies that I have loved into that instead. So sort of just things like we do Star Wars and we do The Matrix and we do The Usual Suspects and we do sort of all of that, and where I want them to be as enthralled by just the movie going experience before they then start to pull it apart critically. And I think what that really taught me is to, in a way, write for your audience. You have to sometimes, because yes, you are absolutely welcome to write for yourself and what you want to do and this, that, but then you're not allowed to get angry when it's not like a sensational New York Times bestseller, right? If it was niche or whatever. But if the goal is to send a message to a particular audience, then you'd better learn what communicates with that audience. And in what way you're sort of likely to communicate with that audience or get through to that audience. And that was definitely one thing that I learned. Being a professional journalist didn't teach me much. Journalism school taught me a lot. Being a professional journalist, there's a very, very hard gap between, I don't know, you went to B school, right? So I don't know if it's like that where you do sort of do your MBA and then you sort of go to a company and it's like a hard crash landing. And there's this gigantic difference between gulf between every ideal you were taught and what's happening. But that's kind of what it was like going from journalism school into journalism. I sort of went from this. I learned, from, like I said, what I learned from journalism school, though, is just how to interrogate ideas and information.
Fair enough. I think that's a good enough takeaway. And I've noticed that like you're very good at breaking stuff down and getting to like this heart of the matter sort of thing. Is this something that you've cultivated over a period of time? Is a skill that you've always had?
I don't think it's a skill that I've always had. I think it's a skill that I'm very much still learning. And there are times when I'm breaking stuff down where that does happen to me, where I'm like for example, if I'm trying to find a theme or a motif in a movie or whatever, I'll have that moment where I'm like, director ne actually socha hai ki main bas matlab kuch bhi bol raha hu. Bas maine se nikal diya aur ho gaya matlab ki haan, ye director bol. The director meant to say this thing. So there's times. But also I have, like I said, I've had the privilege of having access to tools that teach me that. Like the greatest class I ever took, and this again, transformational class, right, at journalism school, was this class called News and Numbers. And it's called News and Numbers because all it does is it gets into how numbers are reported in the news or how numbers are presented in different sources and how you sort of have to look at things like the wording or the sort of sample sizes or things like that to determine what the actual truth of those numbers is versus what agenda the article is trying to push. So you're given great examples of, you know, articles that say things like scientists say that one glass of wine is, you know, beneficial to health or whatever. If you actually do a little digging, where were those numbers from? Who published those numbers? If you found out who published those numbers, who commissioned the study, right? Who this thing? There's a difference between a number that says 20 out of all people have this thing versus 20 of our sample size. What was that sample size? What were the other sort of just the idea that causation and correlation are not necessarily the same thing. And that just sort of changed my ability. And when somebody breaks it down for you at such a fundamental level, there's also this beautiful book that I read about 3 or 4 years ago, I think it came out. I 100% recommend it to everybody. It's called Everybody Lies by Seth Stephens Davidowitz. And it's basically about just big data and about how this sort of new data science revolution and this world of data that we live in, there's a lot of actual physical data, but it's extremely important how you sort of use it and parse it and how it can also be misused in terms of read wrong. And I'm not talking about like Cambridge Analytica and all of that stuff, just read wrong. And it's a great book because it's the opening gambit of the book is he's like, I knew Donald Trump was going to win. That's how he starts. He's like, I am a New York liberal and I knew Donald Trump was going to win because I looked under the emotion and I just looked at the numbers. He's like, I just looked at the numbers. I just looked at this thing and I knew he was going to win like a week in advance that this was like done and all of that. And then he sort of goes from there. And the sort of more you read sort of books like that, that sort of teach you how to pull this stuff apart and how to, again, to use my a favorite reference, how to look at the matrix. I think then you sort of become a little better at pulling stuff apart. I feel like it's a journey that I'm still very much on. And I also feel like it's part of the writer's job to pull things apart to their nuts and bolts and then sort of see how they can be reassembled, right? Especially in this postmodern nightmare that we live in, where everything is a deconstructed version of a previous thing.
No, that's there's so much to unpack over there. But I often feel that where the education system fails is it's removed the ability or the motivation to ask kids to question things.
And critical thinking.
A lot of what is wrong with society, world, whatever it is today, could be solved if we're just a little more skeptical about everything from WhatsApp.
Critical thinking, plain and simple. We do not put a premium on critical thinking. We put a premium on learning and sort of memory-based stuff as opposed to concepts and critical thinking. And it is going to be our doom.
That's a bleak scenario, but let's move on from there a little bit.
On that happy note.
let's put you on the spot now a little bit. So, you have sort of made that transition from having being part of this this new little stand-up comedy scene or something like that, to that little bit of fame scenario. I remember that time Amba had something beautiful, which he said during AIB Divas, I think it was, in that open-air thing that you guys had done all that time back. He said, we are in that weird phase where we are famous, but not famous. You know, he had that sort beautiful line he used at that point of time. And right now, of course, you are known at a national level and you have your own Wikipedia page and stuff like that. And it's just a period of 10 to 12 years.
Do I have my own Wikipedia page? When did that happen?
Come on, Rohan.
No. I swear to God, until about like a year ago, this thing wasn't there. And I actually did not... Wait. Once I have to go look this up. Really? Excellent. I have a Wikipedia page?
Live reaction. Yes, you do.
Holy shit, I have a Wikipedia page.
Congratulations, I guess.
I have a Wikipedia page.
If you just Google yourself, the first image that comes up is a very, very... it's a very... kiddish.
It's a fascinating one.
So enjoy this live reaction.
So, I have no... I'm sorry. It was genuinely a shock to me.
Do you want to make a military?
No. It's fine. It's fine. All right. It's fine. You know what's way more fun for perspective and humility? I've realized this. I have a Google alert set for my name. Every time Rohan Joshi is mentioned somewhere in this thing. Two data points that emerge. Mm-hmm. One is there are a lot of Rohan Joshis in the world. Two, I am nowhere near the most successful Rohan Joshi. there's a Rohan Joshi who was kicking ass in some tennis championship in Ontario. There's a Rohan Joshi who won a math Olympiad somewhere. I was going through this and this notification came and I remember I was sitting on my couch. And I was watching Rick and Morty and I was like, what am I doing with my life? But yeah.
Was that you thinking that way? Or was that you thinking like Google Alert telling me, what am I doing with my life?
I was just also very simultaneously proud that I'm like, there is a Rohan Joshi killing it somewhere out there at all times. And I think that's all that matters.
All right. Hopefully they think the same way as well. Here I am winning tennis tournaments in Ontario where somebody is performing on stage. And
I feel really bad for the other Rohan Joshi that they have Google Alert set to their name because this guy is getting up for a tennis tournament and suddenly case filed against. Wait, what? What? Yeah. Why is there a case against me? I'm a 16-year-old tennis player.
The reason I brought that up was I find fascinating, like that you've gone from, like, the first time I saw you, for example, was when you were hosting that open mic at Bonobo all those years back, 2012 or something like that. And it's like all this has happened in such a short period of time, like 6, 7, 8 years or something, and it's like gone up the ladder quickly. So what I want to ask is sort of really is, like, when did you feel you were going up, leveling up as it were? And how did you sort of deal with it? Like, I'm pretty sure, like, you've had, like, how do you deal with, like, the sudden fame that's happened at every step, really? Fame also means different, has different.
Yeah, levels, sure. Right? I think leveling up, I think we realized after the YouTube channel started working. Mm-hmm. That was, I think, the first time that I got this sense of, whoa, okay.
And when
now
you say
this has become something else only.
Right. When you say working, you mean because some people working might be just getting 2,000 views.
No. This was, so the first 2-3 videos did, like, okay, there were a couple of thousand views. But then I remember you did a video with Kalki and Vijay Juhi called It's Up. And that got like millions of views.
Yeah.
Like millions. And I'd never experienced anything like that in my life before. And then we did 2-3 more videos. And then the same thing happened with those.
Yeah.
And I think that was the first time I sort of looked around and went, oh shit, I guess this is a career now. This is a straight up, like, this is what I'm doing for the foreseeable future. This is at least the next 5 to 10 years of my life.
Wow.
This is it. Like, and just then when sort of people who we never thought we would interact with in our lives started reaching out to us to do things. And I think that was the point at which we went, this is, for better or for worse, we are now part of the culture. And I think that was it. As for how I handled it is, I've also had a career where you can say fortunately, unfortunately, it's a gift, it's a curse, where I've seen some great highs, but I've also been sent back to square one very often. So as a result of that, I've leveled up several times, but I've also had to start from scratch on multiple occasions. So there's a certain amount of, I don't want to use the word humility because I don't think I'm a humble person at all, but there's a certain amount of perspective and this thing that comes where you sort of learn over 8 years that I could be on the highest high today, but it could all be gone and I could have to rebuild again, or potentially it may not get rebuilt tomorrow. So I've really learned to just enjoy being while I am. I've really just learned to enjoy that because I've learned the hard way that the ride ends. Yeah. And then if you're lucky, there's another ride to get on to, but rides end.
Nice way of putting it. Yeah, this is emotional HIIT, as it as it were, right?
Yeah.
Very cool. And I'm sure that, you know, despite all that you do with the best of intentions, I'm sure your DM folder on Instagram has more filth than the average air in the owner. How do you deal with trolls and, if I may use this word, ingratitude? Like, I'll tell you, like, I once got spooked out of my life when I got trolled for something that I wrote last year. And it went a little too viral for my comfort enough to shake me, delete, post, everything. And it's always a thing that the one negative comment you remember over hundreds, over the 100 positive things that you might get. And I'm sure you've experienced multiple times at a greater scale. So how do you deal with that?
It's case by case, honestly. Yeah. Like, I would say that, by and large, I've learned to have a thick skin, etc. But it really depends on the sort of day I'm having.
Yeah.
If I'm having a great day, top of the world, everything going fine, and some, like, 16-year-old, like, just, like, nonsense. But if you're already having a bad day, and if you're tired, and if you've, like, put effort into whether it's a reel or a thought or just taking a stand, and somebody just says something, and then there's just, like, there'll always be one comment that gets past your armor.
Yeah,
and then that can really ruin my day. So it's case by case. I'm trying to, which is also why I'm consciously trying to be better and better about things like not reading the comments or not being affected by what somebody says in like a moment of like 16-year-old anger or whatever. I don't care. Like I'm trying to like not care. Mm-hmm. But if I were to be completely honest, it's case by case. There's days where it's like, ping, and there's days where it's like, oh, why?
Yeah, it's the best and it's really the best and the worst. is it? The okay, we're like sort of like coming towards the end of this, and a few last things that I want to ask you. So one is, you seem to be a guy who takes away lessons from various spaces and from every experience that you end up having. So I guess
party, if you have anxiety and you have to overthink every situation you're in and pull it apart by nuts and bolts and go through every hypothetical, the least the anxiety can do for you is present a tiny lesson along the way.
Fair
like
enough.
The least it can do is fair that. So it doesn't come from a place of being in any way zen or profound or having reached some level of like intellectual this thing. When seeing it, it's just the remainder / byproduct of anxious spirals. It's a little perspective. That's it. I wish I could say it comes from some great this thing, but unfortunately not.
Yeah. No, what I wanted to ask you was, do you map information that you get from various spaces in any sort of way? My guess is part of this comes with the territory of being an observational comic, but just wanted to know, like all that you do, or like something that you did from workout or something that you read can possibly find its way into your head in a mental map of sorts. Just wondered if you had anything like that you do.
I think where I've been massively fortunate is, I've been very fortunate to lead a life where I have been exposed to many different experiences, many different people, many different kinds of people, many people with lives diametrically opposite to mine, many people who come from worlds and lives that I could not have imagined, as a sheltered sort of South Bombay kid. Mm-hmm. And I mean this like, from the perspective of, I have, as a result of my job, I think just as a result of what I do, I meet more people than the average person meets.
Yes.
I see more people than the average person sees. And I've had the fortune of seeing those people and meeting those people around the world and around the country and around the city and around the everything. And the one thing that has happened as a result of that is that I've learned a little bit, and again, not perfect at this, but part of my mapping process is, any situation or any person I meet, I just try to approach it from the perspective of a little empathy for them.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
Because I've now seen and met so many different kinds of people that I don't take any stereotype for granted.
Mm.
Right? Like in the sense that I try to not take sort of any stereotype or any of this thing. So today, whether it's working out or whether it's meeting somebody, or even if it's meeting somebody I don't dislike or somebody or something like that, I just try to walk like a mile in their shoes.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the sense of, just try to walk in their shoes for a bit
before
sort of casting my own judgment upon them, which is, I think if you had to boil it down into one lesson, is that temper judgment with empathy.
Yeah, beautiful. I think that's...
If you can temper judgment with empathy, I think it really challenges and lends different these things to perspective. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, so very nicely said. All right, penultimate question, Rohan. Actually, this is sort of like a rapid fire recommendation round. You're a guy who makes a lot of recommendations, so I think you do a damn good job of this. So I'm going to throw you a set of situations and takeaways, and what do you recommend something for me? It could be a book, podcast, YouTube channel, a specific video, absolutely anything.
We get to the part of the podcast with things that I'm good at.
Yeah.
After an hour of focusing on all the things I'm terrible at, we finally get to my area of expertise.
Absolutely. Something for when you're feeling down.
Oh, something for when you're feeling down. What sort of down is this? Are we talking like your bad day at work? You've had like what?
Bad day at work. Bad day at work sounds good. Yeah.
Oh, feeling bad? You've had a bad Ted Lasso.
What?
Ted Lasso. Ted Lasso is a show that is currently on Apple TV Plus.
Okay.
It is far and away the most joyous, heartwarming, feel good, like opposite of the year 2020 show.
Sort of thing.
Ever. It's got Jason Sudeikis, who plays an American football college coach, who suddenly gets drafted to coach a Premier League football team in the UK. And he's just sort of like a very Munna Bhai meets Forrest Gump figure who just sort of takes to the job with great gusto. And it just goes on to become like, and it's like, how can you say no to a good sports film or a good sports show, right?
Yep.
Like what is more uplifting than a good sports story?
Yep.
And like Ted Lasso, it's like a hug, but as a TV show.
Excellent. And for people who don't have Apple TV Plus or don't want to get too creative with their content sourcing mechanism, anything that you could recommend?
Yes. Is there anything I could recommend for them? Music. Anything by the Rolling Stones. Anything by the Rolling Stones is great. I have a playlist called Wake and Bake on Spotify, which is I also have a bunch of like sort of happy music playlists called Breathe, You Got This. If you go look for Rohan Joshi on Spotify, you can find like these are playlists that I've specifically made that have like happy and relaxed music. If you've had a down day and sort of just if you listen to the playlist in order, it just sort of gets happier and happier and happier.
I remember you putting that out. And if I remember, somebody had made a GeoSavin version of this as well. I remember that.
If you want a book, anything by Bill Bryson. Cheer you up. Anything by Bill Bryson will cheer you up. If you want to cry all your feelings out, but in a good way, book called A Man Called Ove. Yeah.
Okay, fantastic. That's number one. Second, something to tell you how insignificant you are in the larger scheme of things in the universe.
Cosmos.
Yeah.
Just watch Cosmos or read Cosmos. We are very fortunate to live right now in a time of, I think, some of the greatest pop science writing at any time in history, right? Mm-hmm. At any time in history. So I think any sort of best-selling book that's about the universe or about the earth or about our place in the universe.
Yeah.
So like Bill Bryson's A Brief History of Nearly Everything. If you want to realize how insignificant you are, so the Cosmos or A Brief History of Nearly Everything will definitely make you realize how insignificant you are. But in a very good way. In a way where you're also, you're insignificant, but you're part of something larger all the same.
Yeah.
Like, and those.
Yeah.
But if you also at the same time want to feel the feeling of what a miracle you are, please read Bill Bryson's The Human Body, A Guide for Occupants.
Yeah, love that.
You are a complex, marvelous machine. And never forget it.
Thank you. Music that your friends know specifically that you enjoy. If it comes on a playlist, they'd be like, oh yeah, Rohan's band.
Oh, so there's two things. One is like power punk. So your Blink 182, Green Day.
Really?
If all of that stuff comes in, you know that's me playing the music.
Oh, wow.
Two. If there's a playlist going on and randomly in the middle of it, some like instrumental, this thing from some background score from a movie starts playing, if it's on shuffle, you know, that was probably me.
You.
And the third thing is if it's like that 80s type sort of synthwave VHS collection, the midnight type stuff, it's probably me.
Fantastic.
I have the basic ass music taste of a California white boy. It's very sad.
I recently saw a video thumbnail that says teenagers react to Green Day. It really hasn't been that long. Really?
It has been that long. You realize? Have you ever listened to a retro music show recently?
A retro music show like?
I urge you to look out, like seek out retro playlists and playlists labeled retro and just listen to a few of them. You'd be surprised at what passes for retro. That song that you think came out 3 years ago, it's about 45 years old now.
It's really not. I remember seeing during the GABA test, like, wow, it's so amazing that this comes on the heels of the 20th year anniversary of the Calcutta 2001. Like 20 years, really.
20 years.
Yeah, sometimes I enjoy doing these sort of things, like how time sort of like screws with you. And the time from India's independence to Metallica's first album is shorter than Metallica's first album to now.
How's that for some perspective?
Yeah, that's perspective for you. All right, something from your childhood that you'd still enjoy today, food not allowed.
Something from my childhood that I still enjoy today, food not allowed. Tom and Jerry. The Simpsons.
Yeah.
What else from my childhood that I still enjoy?
I think those are good enough, actually.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's a non-entertainment YouTube channel.
Okay. So, don't judge me. There's a channel called Jim Can't Swim.
Okay.
It is exclusively dedicated to just uploaded videos of, and these are real actual videos, not dramatic reenactments, nothing. Basically, these like interrogation videos of hardened criminals.
Okay.
Complete with like annotations and with these things of tactics that either the police are using at that point to wear the criminal down or signs or particular sort of tendencies, whether psychopathic or whatever, or denial or whatever that is being shown by the person being interrogated at that point And yeah, there's like interrogation tapes of like whether it's serial killers, murderers, thieves, frauds, and all sorts of things. And it is quite a sort of this thing, but it's quite an insight into the human mind.
Amazing. Have you heard of Jimmel Painted?
No, I have not.
So Jimmel Painted is this long-running Twitter and Instagram account where a guy will paint anything that you ask him using MS Paint. So you need to give him a blurred situation and he'll draw it for you free. His latest one, which was uploaded 17 hours ago, was, can you please paint the artist formerly known as Prince having a fight with Prince Harry over who is the least known as Prince now? In the background, we can see the Queen. Queen as in the band, then the royal, also fighting over a similar thing and as requested by whoever. So it's hilarious. So there's all sorts
of things. That's amazing.
Yeah, so I'll send that across to you. And finally, three things for the hypothetical situation where you are elevated. Completely hypothetical situation.
Where I'm what? Where I'm elevated?
Elevated, let's just say.
What does elevated mean? I'm so unelevated, I don't even know what elevated means. I'm just frantically staring. Oh, for when you're hypothetical situations where you're elevated, anything by the director Alejandro Jodorowsky.
All right.
Find those movies if you can. Sit back, enjoy yourself. Also, if you're elevated, find a space where you have a lot of nature to look at. Find the nicest pair of headphones or speaker that you can and play Pink Floyd's Animals end to end.
Cover to cover.
And enjoy.
Yeah.
And enjoy. And what third thing? Ooh, what third thing?
This could be possibly food. Suggest? This could be food. Yeah.
Oh, this could be food. Oh, that's easy then. Belgian chocolate. Haagen-Dazs Belgian chocolate ice cream.
Super.
For extra points, you take the Belgian chocolate ice cream and then you take a dairy milk and then you break bits of dairy milk into the Belgian chocolate ice cream and then you eat it. And that's diabetes, kids.
And there goes my OMAD for the day. So I'll give you a couple of recommendations. These are all, of course, purely academic discussions. So this is something I think you particularly will thoroughly enjoy, given that you like Rick and Morty kind of things. So this is an old British series called Monkey Dust. Monkey Dust. You will not find it on any of the streaming platforms, so you might have to.
I'll find it. Chuck, I'll find it.
Yeah. So this is a combination of the. Of Monkey Dust along with, say, if you were to say, okay, what if Rick and Morty were written by the same guys who wrote Monty Python? I think this would be the answer. So this is so quite weird, and it's dark.
That's beautiful.
So I think you will thoroughly enjoy. There are only three seasons in any case, and there are lots of recurring jokes, so it gets better the more you go into it. So I think you will thoroughly enjoy that. That would be my one recommendation for you. All right. Last question now. We have already spoken for a fair bit. We'll wrap up in about 5 minutes, I promise. So last question. You once commented that you would never give TEDx on an abstract random topic, right? And you were comfortable doing two things. One, either telling jokes or two, telling people about your experience of telling jokes around the country. So put you on the spot a little bit over here and just say, what have you actually learned telling jokes around the country? One good thing and one bad thing about yourself and the country, respectively.
One good thing and one bad thing.
It's like a matrix, but not the Wachowski matrix. It's like a
Let's start with the country. One good thing I will say that I have learned about the country is that people will surprise you. Assumptions are stupid sometimes because you will walk into rooms and you will see like the most grandmother, grandfather looking people there and be like, oh man, this is going to be a tough show. And 5 minutes into the show, you realize that they are laughing harder than anybody else.
Yes.
And instead, there's a 16-year-old who should be your audience who's just sort of sitting there looking at you like that. That's one good thing.
He probably got his grandparents to watch the show.
Probably did. What's one bad thing that I learned telling jokes around the country?
If you're struggling to think, then that's a good thing, I guess.
No, I mean, I have a lot of amazing learnings just by putting stuff up on the internet. I think, the bad learning is also that people will surprise
you. Right?
With the inanity of what they will choose to be offended by.
Yeah.
And about myself, what's one good thing I learned about myself? I can make early morning flights on time. It's a good thing that I learned about myself. What's a bad thing that I learned about myself? a bad thing that I learned about myself going around the country telling jokes is that I wish I was better at just the act of going around the country.
Yeah.
I'm very much one of those people that needs to return to base ever so often to charge. Mm-hmm. And I wish I was a little more like those people who be like, fuck it, I will just be out and about and on the road for 6 months and I'll be fine.
Touring
and this thing. But unfortunately, I'm not that guy. I need to keep sort of coming back to
all right.
home base.
And fantastic. Superb. Rohan, thanks, man. On behalf of many, many people, I want to say thanks. So here's one thing. It's a pleasure, and I don't say this for too many comedians. It's a pleasure to read comments on your YouTube videos because it's actually a fairly positive place, really. One of the most powerful pieces of content you ever put out was during Spoken Fest last year. In a spectacular video titled Anxiously Yours for those who haven't seen it yet, where you had this wonderful line, remember that you are someone else's source of strength. And one of the comments on that video, I don't know if you've seen that, is I always come back to this video when I have a crappy day. I hope Rohan sees this comment and realizes that he has been a source of strength to many people. So thank you for being a source of strength to many people. And I hope you end up...
Thank you for reading that to me. You've brightened up my day by telling me that. I'm going to go off and have a very nice evening because of that. Thank you, genuinely.
I really hope you end up writing a book someday. One of the pithiest and most profound lines I have ever come across is the opposite of happiness is not wrong. So yeah, that's... fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
What are you up to? What are you up to? What can people look forward to? Right now,
people can look forward to some Instagram content. And if I can get my discipline in there, some YouTube streams, I really want to start doing 30 questions again. I really enjoyed doing it. But other than that, this is going to be a sort of quieter year in the sense that I really want to focus on getting writing done.
Mm-hmm.
And not sort of worry so much about being sort of daily in people's face through social media. So in that sense, since it's a quiet year, I think we look forward to a quiet year from me.
All right. Awesome. And we look forward to whatever output comes out as a result of that. Rohan, thanks so much, man. I can't thank you enough for being a part of this. And
pleasure's all mine.
I hope you enjoyed that conversation. I thoroughly enjoyed being the person to ask Rohan all those questions. At the end of each of these episodes on Getting Meta, I want to give a couple of takeaways from the episode, which sort of like act as recaps and also like highlights. For me, from this episode, they were, number one, blocking time for various things like fitness and therapy and, you know, having that structure lead to even more structure with all the other activities. Number two, just realistically setting your own goals and figuring out what you want out of life. I thought that part was very powerful. And third is a beautiful line that he said towards the end, tempering judgment with empathy, which I wish was a lesson that everyone around the world would imbibe at an early age. So we spoke about a lot of things during the show, a lot of references and a lot of recommendations from Rohan as well. All of those are in the show notes of this episode, whether you're listening to this on a podcasting app or whether you're watching it on YouTube or anywhere else, including Rohan's special, his speech at Spoken Fest, all the other things that he recommended, the music playlist that he built. Do check them out and do tell me what you thought of this episode. I am at Chuck_Gopal on Twitter and at Chuck of All Trades on Instagram. And Rohan is, of course, Mojo Rojo on Instagram. And he wisely chooses to stay off Twitter these days. See you next week on Getting Meta with another great interview with many more takeaways.
We live in an age of disruption, of immense change in every aspect of work, life, and business. But is the old way of doing things truly dead? And are we ever going to stop saying the new normal? Join me, Varun Dugirala, on Advertising is Dead every Tuesday as I talk to entrepreneurs, leaders, creators, and change makers from across business, media, marketing, and beyond to dig a little deeper into how we got here, what we're doing now, and where we're headed. You can catch all the episodes of Advertising is Dead on the IBM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Feeling overwhelmed, anxious, struggling with too many obstacles, don't know where your life is headed? Well, if you are dealing with one or all of these, tune into the Positively Unlimited podcast, because in each episode, I share a life lesson, a life hack, a pro tip that can help you get your life back on track. All episodes are available on the IBM website, IBM Podcast app, or wherever it is that you get your podcasts from.